Good morning. Good morning.
Yes.
We don't know what this afternoon may bring, or tomorrow, next week, let alone next year. But one thing we can count on is that God is in control and that He is coming back. Will you please stand and sing to Him this morning?
God's word to the Roman believers tells us, you should behave like God's very own children, adopted into His family and calling Him Father, Father, for His Spirit speaks to us deep in our hearts and tells us that we really are God's children. And since we are His children, we will share His treasures, for everything God gives to His Son Jesus is now ours too.
Choice and alien by birth.
secure from all alarms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, leaning on the everlasting arms. What have I to dread? What have I to fear? Leaning on the everlasting arms. I have blessed peace with my Lord so dear, leaning on the everlasting arms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, safe and secure from all alarms. Leaning on Jesus, leaning on Jesus, leaning on the everlasting arms. I am resolved no longer to linger, charmed by the world's delight. Things that are higher, things that are nobler, these have allured my sight. I will hasten, hasten to him, hasten so glad and free, hasten glad and free, Jesus. Jesus, greater, higher, I will come to thee. I am resolved to follow the Savior, faithful and true each day. Heed what he saith, do what he willeth, he is the living way. I will glad and free, hasten, glad and free, Jesus, Jesus, greatest, highest, I will come to thee.
O Lord, you are the greatest, you are the highest, you reign over all, and we give thanks, God, that you reign over our lives as well, that we come with an attitude of worship and praise, because not only do you have power to reign, but you have great goodness and mercy. And so, Lord, we worship you this day. We pray that you are pleased and honored with the worship that we give from our heart and our soul and our minds. Lord, we pray that you change us in this time so that you could be glorified in us and through us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please be seated. When the power goes out in Beloit at night because of a storm, it can get really very, very dark. That happened again recently in my house. We were looking for something like this so that we could turn on a light to see what was going on because it was dark. For our prayer meditation today, I want to consider a biblical truth that has to do with spiritual light and contrast with darkness. So I invite you to listen as I read John chapter 3, verses 19 through 20, which says, "This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by the truth comes into the light so that it may be plainly seen that they have what they have done has been done in the sight of God." What can we learn from these words from John chapter 3? In this passage, the Apostle John points out the difference between darkness and light. Some of the words he uses to identify with darkness are evil, that it hates the light and there's a fear of being exposed, but the light represents truth and it exposes deeds so that all can be plainly seen. We should approach our prayer time as a church family in consideration of how the light of Jesus has overcome the darkness of evil. We already have prayer joys and concerns that have been passed in by card and other things that have been passed on verbally to the pastoral staff for our prayer time, but we welcome the things that you would share, joys, concerns, and testimonies about whatever it is that's on your heart. What would you share that we could include during our prayer time together? We welcome the things that are on your heart. I'm going to point out one. Back there somewhere, Carol Tolbert is. Can you stand up and give a wave? Welcome, Carol. We're glad you're here. Hey, we're looking forward to catching up with you, and especially next week, as I know you're going to be sharing the message in Sunday school class and special program in the evening. So welcome back, Carol. Be sure and catch up with her and give her a warm welcome. Yes. We'll pray for your mom and her health concerns, and one day at a time, that's what we have to do sometimes. So thank you for sharing that. Other joys, concerns, and testimonies. I'm going to lead us in prayer in just a minute, following a pattern of prayer with the letters of the word ACTS, A-C-T-S, in which A represents adoration or praise, C is for confession, T for thanks, and S for supplication or praying for others. I want to encourage you to be praying on your own. I'll offer some suggestions as we're praying. As I'm praying, I invite you to express your own adoration or worship to God in your own heart, however He prompts you. We do worship you, Lord. We are committed to you, and we acknowledge that you alone are the only creator, sustainer, and giver of life. Blessed be God. You're amazing. You're God alone. You're the wonderful one. No wonder we worship you. No wonder we praise you. Praise God. Praise God. As we move on in our prayer time to a time of confession, I invite you to talk to God in your own heart about your own life, however He prompts you. John 3 reminds us that the light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Lord, we know that we have sinned. We've loved darkness more than light, and we know that only Jesus' light and His sacrifice can save us. So we claim that right now. If we could save ourselves, there would be no need for Jesus to have come. But we need the peace and forgiveness that only He can offer. We acknowledge that we can't do anything in our own power to take away our guilt or to save ourselves. We don't deserve your forgiveness. We can't earn it. We can't pay it back. It's only by grace. It's only as we receive it as a gift. Therefore, we confess our sins and we repent. And we ask for your forgiveness, healing, and cleansing. We continue on in our prayers to a time of giving thanks. I would invite you to thank God in your own heart for whatever it is that God prompts you to thank Him for. Praise God for this church family and the opportunity to worship together today and to encourage one another on our spiritual journey. I pray that you would help us to be in touch and to be able to encourage one another on our journey. We thank you for each one because each is valuable and important and significant. You've created us and you've redeemed us and we are yours. We thank you for the many opportunities for growth and encouragement through small groups and Sunday school opportunities and other encouragement activities. Help us to grow. We give you praise for the Relay for Life event that was held in Chautauqua Park yesterday evening, and for the many people who were able to participate in celebrating life and inspiration and encouragement and raising funds for the battle against cancer. we move on in our prayer time to a time of supplication or praying for others, I invite you to pray in your own heart, however God prompts you, praying for others, however He leads you to pray for them. God, we give you praise for the opportunity to pray along with Renee for her mom, for her ongoing health concerns, and we ask that you would provide direction and wisdom, guidance and protection. Be with her, we pray. We pray for the high school young people going to Christian camp this week. We pray for safety and travel and for positive experiences of encouragement and growth and decisions and taking spiritual steps of obedience. Be with those folks, we pray. We pray with Donna Muncy for her granddaughter Kirsten, and for all that concerns her, we just commit her to your care right now. We pray with Janice Stauffer for Zach Short for healing and recovery following surgery this last week. We pray along with Will and Sue Hutchie for Bernice Hutchie as she continues her battle with cancer. We pray along with Phil Vetter for his mom as she recovers following surgery. We remember Merlin Phobes and pray for him and his continued healing and recovery. We pray for Carol Tolbert and rejoice that she's safely here and pray that she would have a rich time of encouragement and interaction and sharing. We pray that it would fill her cup and that she would be able to be replenished as she prepares for the things that you have in store for her in the future. We also pray for Robbie and Linda Smith and their family, that they would continue to have your presence to guide them and to direct them as they follow your spirit each day, one day at a time. Be with them. We pray for Pastor Cliff as he shares your word today. Fill him, anoint him, use him. Allow him to share the things that have come from his time of prayer and study and meditation. And may your spirit be present to touch and prompt and guide each one who hears, that we wouldn't just know more things, but that we would sense your direction on how to practically apply your truth to our spiritual journey. Help us to be different, to be transformed, to be changed because of our obedience to you. Lord Jesus, we believe that you are the light, and we come to you to have you expose any evil in our hearts. We want to be different. We want to be remade by your spirit and by your light and by your promise. We pray for your hope, your help, and your healing to be with us today. And we pray all these things in the blessed name of Jesus, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen.
Good morning, church. What a beautiful morning it is. Here we are in the house of God, with God, worshiping God. How better could it be this morning? So before I forget, we'll kind of go through the instructions of communion here. The deacons will hand out the elements, and if you're a Christian, a follower of Christ, we invite you to join us in this act, and we just ask that you please hold the elements till all have been served, and we'll take the elements together as a church family. So as elders, we each take our turn offering the communion, and so it's kind of our goal to explain kind of what we're doing here, especially for people that might be kind of new to this. So in order to really understand what we're doing, you kind of have to have an understanding of so much more of what we're about, of what we are as Christians. So we'll give it a whirl. As Christians, you know, a lot of people would call it a religion. And technically, I suppose it could be considered that, but I've never really liked that word. So I usually consider Christianity more as a relationship. It's a relationship with our God, and it's a relationship with each other. in its simplest form, you boil it down, that's what it is. And through this relationship, we have what we call love. We give of ourselves. We serve our God, and we serve other people. And that's our goal. That's what we are asked to be as Christians. And so then you think, well, if we're not doing that, then what is the opposite of love? Well, the opposite of love is selfishness, where we, instead of giving of ourselves, we take for ourselves. And as humans, we are all plagued with that. We're plagued with that selfishness. And that, you know, that leads us to our sin. So then God sent his son, Jesus Christ, to the earth to be a human as well as God at the same time, and to pay that price for our sin by being willing to go to the cross and die on the cross, and to pay that price for our sin, and then rise from the grave 3 days later and have victory over death. And that gives us freedom from that sin. It gives us an opportunity to overcome that sin. And not only that, God gave us his Spirit to dwell among us, to dwell in us. And that Spirit convicts us of our selfishness, of our wrongs. And it also, that Spirit reveals God's truth that helps us overcome the lies that bring us to that selfishness, that bring us to that sin. So then here we are with communion. So what is it? It's an opportunity to come in the presence of God, to come to the cross, to bring ourselves as well as our sin, and it's an opportunity to lay our sin down at the foot of the cross and to walk away from it, to turn from it, to repent is the word we call it, and to accept the freedom from that sin that God gives us. So with that, let's make the most of it. So let us pray. Father, as any good father would know, you know what is best for us. You know our hearts, and you know what is in our hearts. You know all about us. And you have also sent your son to this earth to pay the price for the condition that we have, the selfishness. And we thank you for that. And we thank you that he was willing to make that choice that you demanded of him, that our condition demanded of him. And we also thank you for your Spirit that you have given us. And we just pray now that Spirit can work in us, that it can penetrate any hardness or bitterness in our hearts, overcome any pride, any shame, any guilt, and that we can see past, see your truth and see past the lies and be willing to lay down our sin and to turn from it. And we just thank you for this opportunity, Lord. It's in your son's name, Jesus, we pray. Amen. Thank you. So just as Jesus did with his disciples so many years ago, this is what we were going to do. And while they were eating, Jesus took the bread, and he had given thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body." Then he took a cup, and he had given thanks, and he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sins." So we know that as Christians now, we are called to be givers, to be people that serve. And so God has graciously given so much to us, and he has entrusted us with certain things, with certain abilities, with certain talents, with certain physical assets, if you will. And so here we are, our time of offering, and this is another opportunity to fulfill that purpose as givers. Let us pray. Dear Father, again, you know our hearts, and you know what you have given us and what you have called us to do. Lord, I just pray that you would bless what we give today, and please bless the hearts of the givers. We again say this in the name of your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Good morning, church. You look good today. Thanks for coming out, worshiping together, to honor God together. It's a great thing to have you here today. I want to mention a few things from your bulletin to highlight before we get to our message. This week, we are the church responsible for Meals on Wheels, and I think I looked out at the Welcome Center. There's a sign up there that there's still some openings. If you can help serve in this way, meets a real need in our community, and you'll see the sign-up sheet out at the Welcome Center to serve Meals on Wheels. Also, just a reminder, next Sunday, we are so glad that Carol's back safely. She will be giving our message and also presenting during our Sunday school time. But in the evening next Sunday, we are going to have a fundraising dinner for Carol, and there's still time, I think, to be a part of that. So please consider that for next Sunday as well. And then a week from this Tuesday, a new women's Bible study begins. Linda Maliff is leading this. Oh, it's going to meet over at the Methodist Church. We're trying to see as many people from different churches to gather would be fantastic. And so if you are available, it's actually available at two different times. You can either meet at 9:30 in the morning or 7 o'clock at night on Tuesdays, starting a week from this Tuesday. And so if you need more information, you can talk with Linda, but it's a great summer study, and we encourage all women to participate in that. And then you'll see other things that are important when you have time to read through. We encourage you to do that, but if you have a Bible, I'd like to ask you to take that out at this time. We're going to read 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. If you have been tracking with us, we're working our way through this letter. And then after a couple-week break, we're going to actually work through the second letter that Paul wrote to this same church. But we're nearing the end of this first one. We're going to read verses 1 through 11 of chapter 5, remembering that this is God's word. Now, brothers and sisters, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you, for you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night. While people are saying peace and safety, destruction will come on them suddenly, as labor pains on a pregnant woman, and they will not escape. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness so that this day should surprise you like a thief. You are all children of the light and children of the day. We do not belong to the night or to the darkness. So then, let us not be like others who are asleep, but let us be awake and sober. For those who sleep, sleep at night, and those who get drunk at night. But since we belong to the day, let us be sober, putting on faith and love as a breastplate, and the hope of salvation as a helmet. For God did not appoint us to suffer wrath, but to receive salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. He died for us, so that whether we are awake or asleep, we may live together with him. Therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Let's pray. Father, help us, we pray, to hear you speak from this, your word, this text that we've read, that you can bring life to, that you can use to change not only the way that we think, Lord, but the way that we live. And so we pray that you do that. We know that you can be glorified in us as we surrender our will to yours. Have your way with us this day. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. This text today is really tied to what we talked about last week. And so I need to bring up a verse from what we looked at last week. Last week we talked about death and the hope that we have, the grief that we still experience when a loved one passes away. But when they're in Christ, we have tremendous hope. We talked about that. Paul mentioned that in the context of something that I think kind of gets overlooked as we talk about Christians and what we believe and what we talk about, and that is the second coming of Christ. And back in the fourth chapter, these are two verses that will play off of and attach to what we're looking at today. 1 Thessalonians 4:16 and 17, "For the Lord himself," Paul says, "will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so we will be with the Lord forever." And from that, we talk mostly about the hope of death that comes out of that. Today, I want to shift our focus to this hope of Christ's return. And I confess, it's an area that I have not preached and taught on a whole lot. I mean, we do this as believers in probably just about every church. We focus on Jesus' birth. Every Christmas, we talk about, hey, he was born of a virgin, God, Emmanuel with us. God breaks into our world, fully human, fully God. So we talk a lot about that every year. We talk about the life of Christ throughout the year, preaching and teaching on his life from the Gospels and what the rest of the New Testament talks about Jesus' life. We talk about his death and his resurrection. Every Easter, we're going to make sure that we come back and we focus on that and say, well, yeah, these are things to really remember and to bolster our faith with. But from his death and resurrection, we don't talk too much. And yet, there are two significant events that the Scriptures talk about that happened after Jesus rose from the dead that we need to not only be aware of, but then integrate into the way that we live every day. This is what Paul is actually pointing to here. And the two events are this. After Jesus rose from the dead, a lot of people are like, yeah, so what happens after that? Well, the Scriptures tell us that for a period of 40 days, so just over a month, Jesus appeared many times to many different witnesses, proving that he was in fact alive. He ate with them, he drank with them, he allowed them to touch him. This was to make sure there was no mistake. This was not a mirage. This was not a vision. This was actually Jesus raised from the dead again. So for a period of 40 days, he does that. And while he does that, he teaches them. At the end of that period, though, we're also told of another significant thing that happened, and that is, while Jesus' disciples were with him, they saw this, they witnessed this, that Jesus rose into the air, he ascended to heaven, he was hidden from their sight by a cloud, and this amazing, incredible, miraculous thing to see Jesus raised up into the air and then hidden by a cloud, they're staring, kind of gawking up into the air. And it says, Acts chapter 1 tells us this, that two angels are there, two men dressed in white, and they say to the disciples, why are you staring up in the sky? Which seems like the most obvious question in the world. Well, it's not every day that I see Jesus rise up into the sky. They're like, don't worry, he's going to come back in the same way that you've seen him go. So this tells us the beginning of this whole idea. The scriptures will talk a lot about this. The second coming of Christ. It's established right at his ascension. This same Jesus is going to come back in the same way that you've seen him go. And so from there on, the New Testament begins to talk very clearly and openly about the second coming of Christ, the return of Christ. In fact, there are over 300 verses in the New Testament alone that speak about the day of the Lord or the return of Christ, the coming of Christ. And I'd like to read all 300 of those verses to you right now, but that probably wouldn't be a good use of our time. So what I'm going to do instead is try to, and you'll see in your bulletin, I've kind of peppered in your message notes lots of different places. I pray always when I do that, that it doesn't just kind of overwhelm you, but that you take time when you have time to read more thoroughly these verses that I'm just going to have time to skim over and reference briefly. But here's the idea behind it. This coming of Christ, this second coming, the return of Christ, is not some kind of peripheral idea or thought for Christians. Remember, Paul's writing this letter to a group of believers that aren't believers very long at all. Paul was forced to leave Thessalonica before he wanted to. They were very brand new baby Christians, just beginning to get the basics of what it meant to be a follower of Christ. And in the basics, Paul talks about the return of Christ. So this is not just for some kind of advanced level of Christian. This is the very basics of what it means to be a follower of Christ, is to know, to anticipate, to expect that Jesus will in fact return again. There's a couple of words here I want to clarify just for defining sakes here, because I think if you've heard someone talk about the second coming, almost certainly you've heard about some of these terms. I think it's good to kind of clear them up if they're not clear in your mind. One word is rapture. Anybody heard the word rapture? Let me just see where we're at with this. Sometimes these are brand new phrases and words for people. The word rapture is used a lot to talk about this second coming. Some people say, hey, Cliff, I know the word rapture is not in the Bible anywhere. You're right. You could do a little concordance search. You're not going to find the word rapture. But where it comes from is actually from these verses in 1 Thessalonians 4. When it uses the phrase caught up, that when Jesus comes back, that the believers will be caught up with him in the air. That phrase, caught up, it's actually in Greek, but when it's translated into Latin, it comes out with the word rapire. And from that Latin word, we get the word rapture. So if you're wondering where the word rapture comes from, it comes from that whole translation into Latin and to English. So rapture is right out of the scriptures in terms of being caught up. That's what rapture means, to be caught up with the Lord. So rapture means when Christ's return in that sense. Now, there's two other words that you probably will hear if you hear people talk about the second coming. Real quick here. But they're important words, and again, they are biblically based, so it's important for us to kind of grasp some of this. One of the words is tribulation. You'll hear a lot of talk about the tribulation in connection to Christ's return. And the primary question about tribulation is the scriptures tell us that if you're going to follow Christ, you're going to suffer. Jesus says you can expect tribulation, you can expect persecution. By having him Lord of our life, it's going to come into conflict with the culture around us, and we're going to suffer. So that's true in a general sense. But there are some places in the Bible that talk about, yeah, but there's going to be a great tribulation. The book of Revelation talks about a great tribulation. Matthew 24 gives an indication of a kind of persecution and tribulation that's going to be to another level than just kind of the general suffering that Christians have suffered throughout history. And so this great tribulation, the primary question that people ask in relation to Christ's coming is that going to happen before or after we're caught up with the Lord in the air? And Christians disagree on this. There's a lot of different answers on this deal. If you believe that you are going to be caught up with the Lord in the air, raptured, before this time of great tribulation, we call you a pre-trib person. You're a pre-tribber because you think you're going to be caught up before. If you think, no, Christians are going to go through a great tribulation and then Christ is going to come, then we call you a post-tribber, because the idea is that you, after the tribulation, comes the second coming of Christ. For the record, your pastor, I am a post-tribulation guy. I believe, as I look at the scriptures, and I don't believe this, by the way, I don't believe that we're going to go through suffering simply because I have this kind of morbid attachment to suffering because I'm a Cubs fan. That's not why I'm a post-tribber. The reason I believe that we as Christians, if we're alive in this period of a great, that we're going to go through it, the reason I believe that is as I interpret the scriptures. I see that we were actually called into a kind of a life that not only general suffering that makes sense, then that we would even go through this great tribulation, but that God is faithful and that he will pull his people through such a horrific and difficult time. Now, if we disagree on that sort of thing, it's okay. In fact, I'd be happy to be wrong as a post-tribber. I really would. I would be happy to be wrong on this, that we wouldn't go through it. But the way I read and interpret the scriptures, I think that we will. If we're alive, we're going to have to go through a terrible period of tribulation. There's another word, though, that we need to kind of get a handle on, and that is millennium. It's like, what in the world is that word, Cliff? Well, in the book of Revelation, again, chapter 20, it talks about a 1,000-year period of time when Christ and the saints will reign. And so the question again is, it's always in reference, notice this, all these terms are always in reference to when is Christ going to return? And so the question of the millennium is that something describing something that's going to happen before Christ returns or after Christ returns? And then there's actually a third option here where a lot of people say, we think it's actually a metaphor, a kind of a just a symbol. The 1,000 years is a symbol of what got Christ reigning even now. Because when he ascended to heaven, these are folks who would say this, that he ascended to the right hand of the Father, and he reigns now. In fact, we sing that a lot. God reigns. Our God reigns. So there's three options here. You're either a pre-millennial person, Christ is going to return before that time. Post-millennial, Christ is going to return at the end of that period. Or you're an a-millennial person, which is that you think it's symbolic of what is happening even now. For the record, I'm a pre-mill guy. So I'm a post-trib, pre-mill, except on odd-numbered months and when I'm kind of leaning towards a-mill. And that's what I just kind of, there are difficult decisions to make in terms of interpreting those things. I mention all that not to glaze you over, but I think I've already done that for some of you. It's like I've lost you. Come back on me just for a second here. The idea behind this is that these are things worth studying because they're in the scriptures. You're going to see Christians disagree on this. We do not believe that this is an area that ought to cause division between Christians. That we ought to be able to worship together, that if you're sitting next to a pre-tribber and you're a post-tribber, that you ought to be able to worship Christ together and not have that become a division between you. Too many times it does. So we want to make that really clear. We also want you to understand that Paul is going to kind of drill in here and say, these are things that are important to know. But the most important thing that he wants us to understand, and this is going to be true throughout the scriptures, is not that we come to some kind of conceptual idea with all of these terms, but that we come to know him better. That's the goal. If you're saying, well, millennialism and tribulation, the goal of the scriptures revealing that to us, why God reveals that to us, why? to know him better, to love him. Don't lose sight of that. It's easy to when you get into these kinds of studies. It really is. You get into all the details and you're arguing concepts and we forget the most important thing. Why does God reveal this? To know him, to serve him, to follow him faithfully. Paul wants that for this church as well. He wants them to actually be expectant. So let me come back to our chapter here, chapter 5. Look what he says. Brothers and sisters, about times and dates, which I've just been talking about, about times and dates, we do not need to write to you. For you know very well that the day of the Lord will come like a thief in the night, as labor pains on a pregnant woman. He uses two illustrations here to help us think about this. But you, brothers and sisters, are not in darkness so that this day should surprise you. Now, it's interesting. He brings two things together here. He says, on the one hand, don't worry about times and dates. He said, we don't need to write to you about times and dates. He's not indicating that because I've already told you exactly when the time and date is going to be. The reason he says that is because he's actually drawing the very same language from what Jesus said back in Acts chapter 1. It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. That was Jesus' response when the disciples specifically asked Jesus, when is this going to all take place? When's it all going to shake out? And Jesus says it's not for you to know the times or dates. Jesus had actually talked about this earlier in Matthew 24. About that day or hour, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven, and then this usually blows us away, nor the Son. In other words, Jesus is saying, I don't even know when I'm going to return, that the Father has kept these things for himself. It's in the Father's hands. If I can be okay with that, and I'm actually the one who's coming back, you guys ought to be okay with that, to trust that the Father knows the times or dates. Don't fret over the times or dates. We stress that, and how many times have we heard and seen, gosh, just in my lifetime alone, I was just kind of going back and recounting it for this message, how many times that I have heard specific Christians go on very specifically about when it's going to happen, times and dates. Back in 1981, this was shortly after I was a Christian, there was a big megachurch pastor out in California. His name was Chuck Smith. And he predicted, before the end of 1981, Jesus is going to return. I was scheduled to graduate in 1982. That was a big deal for me. I thought, really? He's going to come back before I graduate. Didn't happen. Pat Robertson gave a rock-solid guarantee that the end of the world was coming in October or November of 1982. Hal Lindsey, a lot of you maybe are aware of these books. In the 1970s, Hal Lindsey wrote The Late Great Planet Earth, and then he wrote kind of a sequel to that called The 1980s, Countdown to Armageddon, because he was convinced, as he was studying Scripture, he felt like, hey, these events that are happening in our newspapers, the formation of Israel as a nation in 1948, he felt that was so significant that within a generation that Christ would return. And he defined a generation. He said, I think the Bible defines a generation as 40 years. Do the math, that comes out to 1988, right? So 1988, he said, no later than that would Christ come back. Didn't happen. When it didn't happen, interesting, Hal Lindsey said, you know what? It's still within a generation, but I got the start time wrong. It wasn't 1948. It was actually 1967 when they had that six-day war between Israel and Egypt. That's when it was. So 40 years from there, do the math. No later than 2007 will Jesus come back. And more recently, in our own time, remember the whole Harold Camping thing that was on the news? They had big billboards and all that stuff that Jesus was going to come back. And he actually got real specific here about times and dates. May 21st, 2011. And of course, when that didn't happen, he said, no, I got my calculations wrong. It's October 21st of 2011. Didn't happen. I think I even had a girlfriend break up with me once because she said, Christ is coming back so soon, I think it's best I put my focus there. Of course, it didn't stop her from dating other guys in the meantime, but everybody's got an idea. No, it's got to be. Jesus is coming back. I stress all this because if this didn't happen, we could say this once and be done with it. But it happens over and over and over again when the Bible is so clear, when Jesus could not be more clear. Quit worrying about times and dates on this. At the same time, We say, okay, so I'll just kind of block it all out of my mind. Paul doesn't do that. He could say, look, this isn't even worth thinking about or talking about the end time stuff because you guys will so mess it up, so just don't even, let's just move on to daily living in Christ and that sort of thing. No, he says, no, you need to be expectant even when you don't know when it's going to happen. You're not going to know, quit trying to figure that out, but at the same time, don't let go of this most important truth that Christ is coming back, and to have an expectation built into your life, growing in your life actually, that you expect him to return, because Paul says you do not want to be caught by surprise. You shouldn't be caught by surprise. It's hard when you have to wait. Peter wrote these words 2,000 years ago. They ring more true the longer it is before Christ returns. 2 Peter 3:8 and 9. They will say, people are going to say about this whole thing we're talking about this morning, where is this coming? He promised. And then Peter says, but don't forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years. And 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise. He is patient, not wanting anyone to perish. You've heard that. Maybe it's an old story. And I think of it with this verse all the time. Man says to God, hey, God, is it true that a day to you is like 1,000 years to us? And God says, yeah. And he says, well, then a penny to you, God, must be like $1 million to us. God says, well, yeah. Well, Lord, I would love to have one of those pennies. Can I have one of those pennies? And God says, okay, just wait here a minute. Good, I'm so glad you got that. The idea of time. For God, time, of course, is not like we think it's slow. We think it's taking forever. Cliff, you're talking about something that for 2,000 years, Christians have had this very sermon, this very topic discussed. Where is he? Oh, don't think that way, he says. That should just grow your heart with the wonder of a God so loving that he's patient. Because when he comes, the time for choosing is going to be over. And Paul, and here Peter says it, this is so loving of our God to be patient, but to wait with an expectation. Paul uses these two images, a thief in the night. That's the one that usually draws attention. Can I just draw attention to the woman in labor? He says it's sort of like this, because this is a good picture for me. Of course, we had three daughters. My wife, Laura, actually had three C-sections, but only one of them was planned. So when she got to the 8th month of pregnancy, life changed a little bit because, you know, you're kind of get into a little bit more mode of expectation because you're like, hey, gosh, she could go into labor any day now. You know, we're into that final month, the last 4 weeks, and she could go into labor at any time. So you're expecting, but you still have to do what? You still got to live. You still got to do your routines. You know, you got to go through your regular routines of things, but you do it a little bit differently. We have bags that are packed by the side of the bed. We've gone over routes. How are we going to get to the hospital? We've made sure that we've got phone numbers so that, hey, if I'm over here, if I'm gone, if I'm at work, I'm doing this over here, how can I make sure that you can get a hold of me anytime? There's sort of this, you still do the same routines, but you have a built-in expectation. And sometimes that expectation gets you to the point where it's like, gosh, you know, there's a pile of dishes here, and it's the routine to do them. I wish you'd go into labor right now. I wouldn't have to do these, right? And you kind of have this hope that, gosh, if Christ returns, I wish he'd come right now because this has been a hard week or a hard month or a hard year. And gosh, I wish he would come back. That's not a bad kind of idea in your heart. But what Paul says is, since you don't know when he's coming back, build into your routines this ability to continue to do what Christ calls you to do with an expectation that he could return at any time, not to be taken by surprise. And here's how you do the routines. Verses 5, 6, and 8. You are all children of light. So then, let us not be like others. Let us not be like others. There's a difference This is what it really means to wait with an expectation. There's a difference, a transforming difference happening in us. Let us not be like others. Let us be sober. Putting on, and then there's three words here, really key words, faith and love as a breastplate and the hope of salvation as a helmet. Let us not be like others. And then he draws this contrast. You are children of light. Your life ought to have a light to it that those without Christ who don't have that light, who are walking in darkness, living in darkness, the Bible gives all kinds of imagery about that. It ought to show. There ought to be this ability to say, my life needs to be a light. Christ could return today, but until he does, God, make sure that I'm actually living differently for your glory. Because the days probably will get darker. Of course, this is a post-tribber talking. So what I'm seeing is the world not necessarily getting better and better and better. I think you see this too. It seems to be kind of going on this downward slide. But here's the beautiful thing. See, as the world gets darker, do you know that the light shines brighter? As the world gets darker, whatever light you have, even if you think, gosh, it's just this little flashlight that Pastor Dave has pulled out there, that's all I got. You realize when it's pitch black, you can see that thing for miles? That the light actually appears brighter and brighter the darker it gets? That Paul is saying to this young church, I don't know when Christ is going to come back, but when you live with an expectation, you realize even though the world seems to be getting worse and worse, it's actually an opportunity for the church. I don't say this lightly because I realize I'm saying that means more persecution, more trouble. It's more difficult for Christians in a culture, this is true of ours, that is less and less friendly to people of faith, that has more and more antagonism perhaps. And in many cases, certainly around the world, our brothers and sisters experience the kind of persecution that we can only think of sometimes and have no real concept of. What it's like to live in a land where it is actually illegal and you will lose your life to proclaim Christ like we're doing today. That you would never do this in many places around the world. And Paul says, but don't let that bother you. Because if you live in dark times, you live in dark places, children of the light, the world has a clearer opportunity to see Christ in you than ever before. I think this is true of us folks in terms of our culture. I know there's a lot of times where, and I do this too, you kind of bemoan the old days. Oh, gosh. The old days when things were much better, it seemed like, and seemed like so many more people went to church or they were Christians and the culture itself was kind of Christianized in many ways. But I want to tell you, the powerful opportunity here for us as the world gets darker is that people stop confusing the gospel with a great many things that they have confused the gospel with. No kidding. There was a time, certainly when I was a kid, I think most people confused Christianity with being an American. They felt like if I was born an American, I must be a Christian. And that was pretty much true of anybody I went to school with. And they confused the idea that, well, I was born in America, so I'm certainly not a Muslim. I was born in America, so I'm certainly not a Hindu. I was born in America, so I must be a Christian. You realize how hard it is for people to understand that that's not what it is to be a Christian? But it gets easier and easier in the darker times because suddenly the distinction, the difference between what it means to be in Christ and just to have some cultural view and appreciation for Christianity is seen more clearly. Christ is glorified more readily. This is what Paul is trying to encourage this young group of Christians. Faith, love, hope. Faith so that in the dark times and the world seems like it is chaos and out of control, that faith says what? He reigns. The world's out of control. He's still in control. How can you say that with all of these headlines? Because I know my God. There's a faith, there's a trust that the darker it gets, God is not less in control. He still reigns. A love. When the hearts of many grow cold with love, that the Christian community rises up in a time of great darkness and where our children of light who say, we're going to love our enemies. We're going to love those who persecute us. Just as Jesus said, it was hard to figure out how to do that in a time where everybody was really supportive of my faith, but a little bit easier now to recognize those who oppose us and to love them and hope that says, you know what, it feels like spitting in the wind sometimes in the dark times as a Christian. Feels like I'm making no impact, but hope says, no, don't believe that. Everything you do in Jesus' name matters. That's why we say it. It's not just a phrase. I'm telling you this. It's not just a stock phrase I throw out there. Everything you do is on mission when you do it for Jesus. Whether it's quilting, whether it's being a stay-at-home mom, whether it's farming, banking, teaching, everything you do is mission when it's done in Jesus' name. And the hope, the great hope that Christians have is that the darker it gets, it does not lose its impact for eternity. The hope is that what we're talking about, the lives that we're reaching out to love and to reach, it's going to matter for eternity. That's the hope. So Paul says, let us be sober. Let us think clearly about this. Let us put on these things, he says. It's very intentional to think about the return of Christ and to say, today I want to seize this day. He might come back today. I want to be found ready, full of faith, hope, and love. If this is hard, I want to encourage you because, I mean, I'll be honest. When I first became a Christian and, you know, you get the basics of what it means to follow Christ, receive him, and I did that. And then people started telling me about the second coming. I did. I kind of glazed out. I was like, I don't even know what you're talking about, and why is this important? And it was really hard, actually, for me to kind of want. I mean, I'll just say, it was hard for me to want Jesus to return. I mean, when you're a junior in high school, you know, Jesus is going to come back, and I'm not going to get to see the Jedi return, you know. I mean, I'm not going to be able to get my driver's license. I'm not going to be able to find a woman to marry. I'm not going to be able to have a family. I mean, these are all the things. I'm just being honest with you. That's kind of where I was at. So when they would preach and teach about Jesus is coming back, you should be excited about that. I wasn't so excited. It just didn't seem like that great of a deal to me. But I've come to see that I think this is maybe, I hope this is one way to think about it. We'll close with this. I've got three daughters. There was a time, I can't remember which one of them said this to me, but one of them said to me at one time, it's that time when kids say this every once in a while. It's a very brief time, but it happens, where they say, hey, Papa, because they always call me Papa, Papa, when I grow up, can I come and stay with you and Mom and live with you guys for forever? You know, and as a dad, you kind of get that, oh, wow, you know, that's kind of cool. And then you think more about it. It's like, no, you can't. but at the time, you're like, how can I explain to my daughter? She's at that age. She's a little young. How can I explain to her something that's going to be hard for her to grasp right now, this truth? How can I explain to you, my daughter, that something inside you is going to change? You won't be the same as you are today. Something inside you is going to change, and you're going to want to go off on your own. How could I? It almost did no good to kind of explain to her that, you know, one day that there's going to be possibly a guy in your life who's as big and as strong and as handsome and just as wonderful as your papa. And honestly, I thought it was a little far-fetched myself. But, you know, you're trying to explain that to them and say, how can I explain to you that one day there's going to be a guy that you're going to see and meet, and he's going to so draw your desires and attention that you won't even give thought about wanting to come and live with your mom and dad for the rest of your life? How can I explain that to you? But then it happens. See, because then one day your daughter comes to you and she says, Papa, I found him. I found this guy, and I love him, and I want to be with him, and I want to do life with him. And you see it happening. And if you know if the guy's a good enough guy, if you're a good papa, and the guy's a good enough guy, and if your daughter's old enough, like maybe 40 or 45 years old,
And you look at that, only a good papa then is not going to say, no, you should stay with me. A good papa is going to say, that's exactly right. Because guess what? This is what you were made for. You were made. Your mother and I, we actually prayed for this to happen for you from the day you were born. And now you're beginning to experience that desire to be out on your own and to be grown up and to experience that just as you were made to. I think that's part of what we experience now. See, because right now when we say Christ is going to come back, not everybody's heart gets thrilled like, fantastic. But it's sort of that young child that doesn't yet know. Did you know your every desire? Everybody came in here this morning with deep desires. Your every desire is found in Him. There is a groom who's coming for His bride. And your every hope, your every desire, everything you've ever wanted, maybe you've looked for it in the wrong places, but I'm telling you, the desire itself is built into you. It's created by God in you, but it is found in Him so that when He appears, everything you've ever wanted will become crystal clear. Ah, it's in Him. That's how a heart begins to grow in desiring, longing, expecting Jesus to come, because He is what you've always ever wanted. The second last verse of the whole Bible becomes a prayer to that. Jesus actually speaks. He says, He who testifies to these things says, yes, I'm coming soon. And then the prayer is said, amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Let's pray. Father, You are so good and gracious to Your children to tell us this great promise that as Christ has ascended, He will return, that You will send Him back, that He will come with great power and glory, and that we will be caught up with Him. And God, even if our hearts struggle to fully comprehend and grasp that, and no one fully comprehends it yet, but yet we have this glimmer of hope, this seed of hope in us that, yes, Lord, You are all that we've ever desired. So we desire You to come quickly. We desire to see You. We pray, God, that You would grow our hearts in that desire, change us, and in the meantime, Lord, whether it's in our lifetime or not, that we would live as children of light, because the world is getting dark. Help us, God, to honor and glorify You in this way, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close with our closing praise song here, but we want to encourage you, if you need prayer, actually Dave's going to be available in the back to pray for anyone who would have a need, but otherwise, would you stand and let's worship God.
I'm satisfied as long as I Someone wants to obey Jesus and to do it in a public way that glorifies him. This is Jeff Christman, and Jeff is my friend, but more importantly, he is a follower of Jesus Christ, and Jeff has requested baptism. For us, baptism is a sign. It's a way to see what is unseeable. The change that happens in a person's heart when they surrender their life to Christ and the new life that he gives them is not something that physical eyes can see, and yet God gives us a way to begin to picture that and to recognize that, and that's how we see baptism. Baptism is a sign of salvation already received in Christ through faith in him, and so whenever someone expresses that, we want to make sure that we celebrate it together as a church family. So we only ever have one requirement for baptism, and that is a profession of faith in Jesus Christ. And so, Jeff, I'll ask you this one question. Have you accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, sir.
Wonderful. So that for us is a sign that someone is ready to be baptized in response to the command that Jesus gave. So let's go ahead and baptize you. Jeff, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go ahead and pray for Jeff and allow the Holy Spirit to continue to work in him and through him. Father, we pray that very thing, that you would continue to work in and through Jeff, give him all the strength that is needed to face the days to come, Lord. We pray that you protect him against all spiritual attacks, Lord, that his light would shine bright and that you would give him joy as he continues to follow you. Lord, we pray that as a church, we continue to surround him with love and support in our prayers. We pray right now, Lord, that you would continue to be with him and lift him up to you, and in Jesus' name, amen.